بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear brothers and sisters, last Sunday we were expecting Ramadan to be either Monday or Tuesday. Today is the 7th of Ramadan. Can you imagine? Last Sunday looks like yesterday. And today, 7 days passed for Ramadan. This is to show us how short is our life. But unfortunately, we don't know. Or we don't think that our life is very short. So we are wasting our time in doing something to take us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also to show us that we are not thinking in the proper way, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned us in many verses in the Quran and told us this life is very short, and just this life is to take you away from me. But the other life is endless. So you must work for the other life, not for this life. But unfortunately, we are leaving the endless life and we are running, killing one another for this life. Ramadan just is the month that shows us how our time is running. So we must be careful. Sunday, last Sunday, Ramadan doesn't exist yet. But today, 7 days has gone already. Next Sunday, that's it. Half of the month has gone. The second half will be running faster than the first one. And this is one of the wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose always to send the revelation to the prophets and the messengers in the age of 40. Because they came to the middle of their life. So, to show them that the rest of your time must be used to serve the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned last week about the verse 183 from Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2. And we mentioned that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the believers. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Oh, who you believe. So fasting is an honor. So it's not for every Muslim, for only the believers. Allah hasn't said, O Muslims, fasting has been prescribed upon you. No, 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 He said, O believer. And there is a big difference between Muslims and believers. Muslims who are acting Islam, like us. We are acting. We pray, stand, do ruku'a, do sujood, like mashallah you see, most of the mosques here in our people, Allahu Akbar, that's it. This is acting Islam. Not praying. Not even reading Quran. We are insist, I don't know from where they got it, we have to do Khatmul Quran in Ramadan. From where? From where you got that? What is the benefit of Khatmul Quran without understanding one verse? I challenge the people who are praying behind the imam, if they understood one verse from the Quran throughout the month, just one verse, we are disrespecting the Quran. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتٍ. We have sent down this Quran upon you for them to think deeply and يَدَّبَّرُوا. Allah didn't say لِيَتَدَبَّرُوا, no, يَدَّبَّرُوا. And we, if we look at this verb in the present tense, and the present tense give the indication that this action is continuously, all the time. No, يَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ in the time of Prophet Muhammad sallam only, or in the time of the Sahaba, or in the time of the Caliphs, or in the last century. But يَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ all the time, until the day of judgment. Because every day we must get new understanding, better understanding for Quran to suit our time. Because this Quran is covering everything in this universe. But then to make the link between the Quran we are reading and the Quran we are observing in this universe, we must keep thinking all the time. But unfortunately, we are worshipping idols just because we inherited that the people before us, they are doing Quran or Khatm Quran in the Taraweeh prayer, we do the same. That's it. This is not tadabbur. This is not thinking. This is not the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is telling us something and we are doing something else. As we are saying to Allah, no. We don't like the way you are telling us, but we will do it our way. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. This is the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the believer. Because, as we mentioned last week, there is a Muslim and there is a believer. When the Bedouin at the Quran said, قالت الأعراب آمنا. The Bedouin said, we believe. Allah said, no. لا تقولوا آمنا. ولكن قولوا أسلمنا. Say that you are a Muslim. Don't say you are a believer. ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. The belief hasn't come yet to your heart. So the belief, when this religion to be as a nut in my heart, to be fixed in my heart, to all my actions will reflect that I am a believer, then yes, I can say I am a believer. But before that, I have no right to say it. So the fasting is an honor. Not everyone is entitled for this honor. Only the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the believer and said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السِّيَامُ. O believer, or who you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you people who reach it to the stage of the belief, fasting has been prescribed upon you. And we mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here, kutiba is a verb. Subject is not exist. We should say in the verbal sentence in Arabic language, we say the verb, subject, and the object. But here, subject is not exist. Allah should say, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ. Allah has prescribed fasting upon you. But Allah removed the subject. He said, kutiba. Why? To show us how great this fasting. How great this fasting. Because this is only the worshipping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to be for himself. Allah says in Hadith Qudsi, كُلُّ عَمَلِ ابْنِ آدَمَ لَهُ إِلَّا الصَّوْمَ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِكَ. Allah is saying in the Hadith Qudsi, you know Hadith Qudsi, we mentioned that before. Okay, so Allah says in this Hadith, all the deeds of the son of Adam is for him, except the fasting. It's for me. And I am the one who will reward for it. All the deeds is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah only the one who is rewarding us for all our deeds. Why Allah specified the fasting? Because it is secret. Because with this fasting, you achieve to the highest level of Iman. We call it Maqam al-Ihsan. We have a Muslim, we have a believer, and we have a Muhsin. Muhsin, the one who reached to the highest level. With the fasting, you are achieving, you are reaching to this level. How? Because...
Sheikh, yeah, but then wouldn't you argue with yourself,
yes,
that action creates the belief, and the belief reinforces the action?
Mm-hmm.
I've often wondered about this, right?
Yes.
The Prophet says, here's your five pillars of Islam.
Yes.
And then the whole Ummah takes on these five pillars.
Yes.
And now you're saying that, well, has to be matched with belief.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
You see my point or you see my
point? Yeah. I agree. Yeah, you have heard the question of Brother Isaac. Okay. The method that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used with us, He's taking us step by step.
Yeah.
Gradually.
Yes.
So the first level, the lowest one, the first step to come into this house of Islam, these pillars, to start to act. Because when you are acting, you are training your body for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are training how I stand, how I do ruku', how I do sujood, how I do that. Okay, acting to fast, to stop, to eat, to drink. This is the lowest. Just this is the first step to give the impression that I am planning to enter this house of Islam. But you shouldn't stay there. You knock the door, and the door was open for you. Don't stay by the door. You have to come in. I respected you when you knocked the door, and I came to the door, I opened the door for you, okay? Don't stand and let me waiting for you, standing, and you're standing there by the door. You have to stay there, okay? So, this is, you knock the door. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the door for you. Come in. Don't stay by the door, you have to move on. You have to come into. How you will come into that, okay? By making this as an act, not only action, no, but this is coming from my heart. When you start with your relationship with someone, okay, just in the beginning is normal friendship. But by the time, after you see him a couple of times, 3-4 times, now it's not normal, it became now love. It moved now from just normal meeting or shaking hand or having a cup of tea together or something. No. Now become we are ringing one another, we are missing one another. I have to see him every... Now something in your heart now. So this is the second level. Okay. But this is how we must develop. And from this level, we have to move forward. Up. More to Maqam al-Ihsan. Maqam al-Ihsan, as our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described for us, أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you are seeing him. If you cannot see him, make sure he is seeing you. So this is the friendship and our relationship, how it should be, that I love you not for any materialistic reason. I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you love me for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't have this relationship for any benefit or materialistic benefit. This is the ihsan and the friendship. And this is how the relationship between Muslim should be or must be. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in his hadith, سَبْعَةٌ يُظُلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. The seven categories that Allah will shadow them in his shade in the day of judgment. He said, رَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّا فِي اللَّهِ اجْتَمَى عَلَيْهِ وَافْتَرَقَ عَلَيْهِ. Oh my God, رَجُلَانِ. Two men, two brothers. What about the sisters? The same. Why the hadith didn't say رَجُلَانِ أَوْ مُرَأَتَانِ two brothers or two sisters? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only specified the رَجُلَانِ? You know, Islam is teaching us how we must discipline ourselves. When we are talking to the sister, the lady, I shouldn't call her with her name, matter of respect. I call her with the name of her son, name of her daughter, so name of her father, something, no. Okay. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this hadith is teaching us. So in the Quran, Allah is addressing the woman behind the partition of the man. So here, such in this verse you are talking about, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ is a male pronoun. آمَنُوا is a male. Okay. But does the fasting only for the man, not for the woman? It is for both of them, but it's a matter of respect. He's talking to the man. And even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he advised the youth for marriage, he said, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَةَ فَلَا تَزَوَجْ. O youth, the one who had the ability for marriage, he should do. Okay? So, and he explained to us. But when he talk about the girls, he addressed her parents. He said, إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. If someone came to you and he is a religious man, he asked for the hand of your daughter, go ahead. He didn't talk to the girl herself as a matter of respect for her shyness, for her opinion. Okay? But this is the... So, but then we are saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. O believer, fasting is honor. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ as it was prescribed upon the nations before you. Okay. When fasting started actually? Does anyone know? When?
Well, in Muslim form.
No. Before Islam. Allah said the nations before you. When?
Isa started.
Isa. Huh?
Before him?
Who's else? Before him. Huh?
Adam.
Adam alayhi salam, what is else? But a fasting, it started in the time of Noah alayhi salam.
Noah,
your Prophet Noah. You know Prophet Noah?
Yeah.
Okay? After Allah saved him in his ark with his people, okay, he fasted to express his thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the people in India and in the area of the Middle East, although they used to be disbelieved, some of them used to be disbelieved and worship gods and this stuff, but they used to fast to please their gods. Okay? Then in the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam in Harran, in this area of Iraq and Syria, also they started to fast. And the As-Sabi'een, they started to fast also, they used to fast the month of Ramadan. In Judaism and Christianity, fasting was compulsory. Ramadan was compulsory upon them. But they didn't keep it. They couldn't keep it. Because sometimes Ramadan, like now, fall in the some. They couldn't survive with it. Ah, it's a very long time. It's a very long day. And it's hot. We can't survive that. Let us change the location of the month. So they started to move the month of Ramadan to the springtime, March and April. And until now, they are fasting that. The Christian, they are still fasting that and celebrate their festival in the Easter. You know, the Easter, they ended their fasting on that day. And they said, okay, instead if we fast 30 days, we will make it 40 days. It started with 50 days, then they reduce it to be 40 days. Okay, this is... But alhamdulillah, Muslims, at least until now, they still keep Ramadan. But we need to keep Ramadan in the proper way. Okay? Because Allah said in the verse, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Maybe you will achieve to the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then fasting is my way to achieve to the taqwa. What is taqwa? What is taqwa?
Consciousness.
Uh-huh. Yes, what is taqwa?
Fear of Allah.
Fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huh? What is X?
Belief in God.
Love.
Okay.
That's it. Simple like that. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is taqwa. The Quran said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. If he told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say to us, if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, follow me, then Allah will love you. But then the core of our religion is love. I don't know why Muslims, they didn't talk about that. SubhanAllah. Once one of the priests, he was talking to me and he said, you know, I read the Quran and unfortunately I didn't come across the word of love in your Quran. I said to him, are you sure that you have read the Quran? Maybe you have read some other book. Because our Quran is full of love. It might not be with the clear term of love. There is, of course, some word, or many words in the Quran expressing the word of love. But all the command, all the action of the Quran is talking about love. But unfortunately, we always talking about hellfire, punishment in the grave. We will see that. الشجاع الأقرع, the ثعبان in the grave will swallow you when you come. SubhanAllah al-Azim. Why? Why you are putting the people off from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We know our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that the other creation, they are very upset with us. Because we are away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every day, the earth requesting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, let me swallow the son of Adam. Allow me to swallow him because he's eating your rizq and denying your shukr. He's not thanking you for your grace. And the heaven, the sky, saying, oh Allah, let me descend down on the top of the head, son of Adam, to destroy him because he's eating your rizq and denying your shukr. But Allah replying, لو خلقتموه لرحمتموه. If you created them, you will be kind to them. But this is the love. This is the love. But instead, if we scare the people from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, We must make them love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tell them how Allah loved them. If then taqwa is love. Okay. How I achieve to this love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah said through the fasting. كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Maybe you will reach, achieve to the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How I can achieve to that? Okay. What is the fasting? Can you explain to me what is the fasting? But I'm moving away from this materialistic life. When I stop to eat and drink, as you said, okay, if someone is observing me, I can go to behind the door and eat. I came now, I pretend that I'm fasting, okay? But after I leave, I keep some food in my car, so and just will book my hotel and eat, okay? Is anyone is, no one is watching me. But there is, I stop to eat and drink the daytime because I believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching me, observing me. And then, because I love Him, I stop. This is how I start. I'm sacrificing my desires for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is one thing. All my organs, we mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us from what?
Clay.
That's it?
No.
A soul.
And?
A soul.
Yeah, mashallah. And a soul. Okay. From where this clay?
Earth.
From this earth. Okay. What about the soul? From where?
From God.
From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah mentioned to Prophet Muhammad, يسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليل. They are asking you about the soul, about the spirit. Tell them it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have been created from the body and the soul. Okay. We mentioned before to survive I have to feed this body. Can you think, imagine if you stop eating and drinking, if you go to the hunger strike, okay, how long you can survive, okay, and no food, no drink even. Yeah, of course, they force the one who's in hunger strike to drink something. But if he stop eating and drinking, for how long he can survive? Not very long, okay? Then his body will go. Okay, so if I have to feed my body to survive, I'm feeding my body from everything that's coming from this earth. Because I am from there. Allah said, مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ. From this, we created you. وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ. And into this earth, we will return you again. وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. And from the earth will get you out again. But we have been created first from this earth, from this dust, and we will be returned to this earth again, and from this earth Allah will call us again and we will come running again from this earth. About during this time in between the time we have been created until we be returned to the earth, we are still in linking ourselves to this earth, eating from this earth. Everything is coming from this earth. Okay? Because we are a part of it. What about my soul? I have to feed also my soul. I have to feed it. Otherwise, my soul will die. How I can feed my soul? There is a special food? Yes, there is a special food. It's free. Subhanallah al-Azim. To feed my body, this dirty part of me, okay, to feed it, I have to pay money. Or you are getting the food free. We are not getting the food free. We have to pay money for that. But to feed my soul, which is very expensive, but it's free, subhanallah al-azim. But the people running to pay money and not to get the free food. Subhanallah. See how clever we are? How clever we are? Okay? So, but then I have to feed my soul from my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By connecting myself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the prayer, through the fasting. Yani the prayer, fasting, zakah, this is only the way? No. Any good deeds. If you have a good relationship with the people around you, if you are kind to your neighbor, if you are dutiful to your parents, if you are doing your duty towards everyone, if you are good even to the animals and the birds and all the creation around you, it is a good deed. It's a way of the connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unfortunately, we have, or the people have, an idea about us that we are against the animals. We don't tolerate the cats and the dogs and this stuff. We look down at them. They are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that دخلت امرأة النار في هرة حبستها فلا هي أطعمتها وسقتها ولا هي تركتها تأكل من خشاش الأرض. A lady went to the hellfire because of a cat. She imprisoned the cat in a room without food, without drink, and the cat died. Our Prophet told that she will go to the hellfire because of that. He didn't tell because she wasn't praying or she wasn't fasting, not because of this cat. On the other side, our Prophet Muhammad Sallam told us that a lady, she was a sinner, and once she was traveling through the desert and she was very thirsty, about to die. Then at last she found a well of water. She went and she took the water and the drink. She resumed her trip. Then later on she saw a dog, very thirsty. Okay, she remembered how she was before. She went back again to the source of the water and she used her shoes to pick some water and give it to the dog. Our Prophet Muhammad said, Allah forgive her all her sins because of that. And we are saying, dogs, no, you can't get the dogs, you can't touch the dog. So I don't know from where we are going. From where, I don't know that we got this ideas, I don't know. Imam Malik, radiallahu anhu, said, dog is not najis. Just the saliva of the dog, that's it. If you avoid that, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What's the reality?
The reality, the dogs is creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I be kind to them, I will be rewarded for that. Prophet Muhammad said, في كل كبد رطبة أجر. Any creation, any creation, because every creation has a liver. Okay. Every creation, if you be nice, if you be kind, if you feed it, if you treat it in the good way, you will be rewarded for it. Likul, for every creation. Yes.
If you have dog in the house, there's no angel coming. This is
what we're doing. Yeah. That's exactly right, Shia. That's exactly what we're told.
I know. Okay? As long as we are keeping this, covering this, not to touch our clothes when we are praying, that's it. It means any the dogs everywhere, so there is no angels around them. Subhanallah. Yani, I don't know from where the yani, this understanding came to us. So this is the reason I'm saying we need to.
So is that fabricated hadith? I've read something where let's say if you have a dog in the house, the angels don't come inside. I agree with you.
We have a lot of stuff, okay? Right. But if I said the Quran said, and the Hadith of Prophet Muhammad said,
then it goes against.
That's it.
Okay. That's your rule of thumb, isn't it?
Yes. Because la ijtihada ma'a wujudi nas. There is no ijtihad if I have a text, if I have something from the Quran. And or from the Sahih Hadith, no ijtihad. You can't figure it.
Actually, this is a good point from Sheikh. I don't know if it came up in this talk, but once Sheikh said that any hadith that doesn't make sense with the Quran, forget it.
Exactly. Because we have, Prophet Muhammad SAW said, okay, and the Quran said about him, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He will never say anything from his pocket. He's saying what we have taught him. And this is even what the Bible said about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yani Isa alayhi salam in the Bible.
Yes.
Okay. If you go to the Bible and see, yes. He said, "I am not here to tell you all the truth, but the one who will come after me, he will tell you all the truth, because he's not speaking his mind; he is speaking what God told him to say." But this is. Exactly as our Quran said, what came in the Bible about Isa alayhi salam, it is the same what Allah says in Surah An-Najm, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ. Muhammad sallam, he will never say anything from his mind. Whatever he is saying is wahy from us. And this is the wisdom that Prophet Muhammad sallam was an educated person. So no one can claim that he fabricated or he made that. If I am uneducated, am I going to publish books? I don't know how to read and write. Okay? So this is was the wisdom to purify our religion, that no one has done anything or contributed anything to this religion but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the hadith is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He taught him and he told us. Okay? So this is, we must be aware of that. So if the hadith is matching the Quran, alhamdulillah. If it is against the Quran, never be hadith. Never. Never be. You can keep him outside if you are, yani, you would like to make sure that he touch nothing. Okay, keep him outside. Make a room. Set up a room for the dog in the garden outside, okay, and keep it. Feed the dog, feed the cat, feed the birds. Because this is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
That's all taqwa.
Exactly.
That's all
taqwa. Just keep it outside, okay, but feed it. Feed the dog, feed the cat. Okay. Deal with them in the right way, in the nice way. Why we are given the impression that we are not a human being? We're against the other creation. Why? Although the core of our religion is love. Love for everything. It's not only for the human being, for everything, for all the creation. We said this table is doing it a speak. So when I move this table, I must be gentle. The chair, the window, everything. Why? The Quran said that. وَمَا مِن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ. Nothing, shy, anything, everything is doing a tasbih. وَلَكِن لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُ. But you can't understand what they are saying. And our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إِنِّي لَأَعْرِفُ حَجَرًا فِي مَكَّةِ. He said, indeed, I know a rock in Mecca. Whenever I pass by, the rock used to say, السلام عليك يا رسول الله. Should we hit this rock? And say, what's a rock? Huh? It is saying salam to Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad, he said about the mountain of Uhud, Jabal Uhud. You have been there, of course, if you have been to Hajj or Umrah and you visited Medina, you have seen the mountain of Uhud. It's a huge mountain. Okay? Prophet Muhammad said about him, Uhud, Jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbu. Uhud, the mountain, that he loves us and we love him. What that mean? So, the animal. Once the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was walking in the road, and a camel was calling Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Because we know Allah blessed some prophets and the messenger, and he told them the speech of the animals and the birds, like Sulaiman alayhi salam. Sulaiman alayhi salam, he is one of the Jewish prophets and the messenger. His father is Dawood. He is Sulaiman, son of Dawood, David. He is one of the prophets of the children of Israel. Because as we know, who are the children of Israel? The children of Yaqub alayhi salam, Jacob. Yaqub alayhi salam is the son of? Son of Ishaq. Yaqub alayhi salam, the son of? Ishaq, Isaac. And Ishaq is the son of? Ibrahim alayhi salam. The brother of? Ismail alayhi salam, our grandfather. Clear now? So Yaqub, his name is Israel.
We got another name.
Yes.
Okay.
Yani in the Hebrew language, okay, his name is Israel. And Israel as a word is two parts. Israel. Abdullah. This is the meaning of Israel.
Abdullah.
Yes. Isra, Abd, Il, Allah. Okay? Iba Abdu, Allah. Iba, this is the meaning of Israel. This is the name of Yaqub alayhi salam. He had the 12 sons. Okay? Which Yusuf alayhi salam was one of them. So, his 12 sons, we call them the children of Israel. They came to Egypt, stayed there, and they carried on, they corrupted, then Pharaoh tortured them. Anyway, then Allah sent the Musa alayhi salam from them. Okay? Musa alayhi salam was from them. And he took them out of Egypt to Palestine, and they stayed there. He gave them, Allah sent them the Torah. And you mentioned the Torah is the book. When I say the book, means either the Torah or the Quran. Because they are only the two scriptures, they contain Sharia and advices. Sharia, and only in the Torah and the Quran. Bible, there is no Sharia in the Bible. There is no Sharia. The Bible must follow the Sharia in the Torah. But only the two books has Sharia, the Torah, which came to Musa alayhi salam, and the Quran that revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? You know, even in the time of Musa alayhi salam, the children of Israel, they corrupted. And they are used to argue and to disobey. This was one of the reasons that Allah sent to them many prophets and messengers. And they are always denying and rejecting. And sometimes they are killing some of their prophets. Always Allah sending a prophet and the king together. Prophet as the spiritual leader and the king as the politician to lead them. So they used to listen to the king and disobey the prophet. I think you are doing the same now. It's true? Yes. We are listening to our politicians, to our leaders, scared of them, but we are not listening to the religion. Okay? So, may Allah will save us, inshallah. Then, later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed the method. So he joined the king and the prophet in one person. Became one. Dawood alayhi salam. Dawood alayhi salam. He was a prophet and a king at the same time. But Dawood, it was a case, came to him and he failed to sort it out in the right way. Okay? Someone came to him to complain against his partner, his friend. They were sharing business together. So he couldn't do it in the proper way. But Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like to replace Dawood with Sulaiman. So Allah said, فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا Sulaiman. Allah told Sulaiman about the right solution for the case. So Sulaiman sort the case. So he replaced his father, and Sulaiman became also a king and the prophet for the children of Israel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Sulaiman and blessed him with ministers. Okay? He is controlling the jinn. He know the speech of the birds, the animals, and his army and his supporter, all this. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah An-Naml, وَحُشِرَ لِسُلَيْمَانَ جُنُودُهُ مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ وَالطَّيْرِ فَهُمْ يُوزَعُونَ. His army is from jinn and ants and birds, everything. Okay? Also, you know, when his army was walking, and Namla, قالت نملة يا أيها النمل ادخلوا مساكنكم. This ant called amongst the rest, go to your rooms. Otherwise, Sulaiman and his soldier will crush you. Okay? MashaAllah, some of our books of tafsir, they are very concerned about this aunt is male or female. Or this aunt was limbing. She had a problem in one of incident limbing. Okay? And somebody, it was just with one eye. Subhanallah al-Azim. Well, this will benefit us to show you that how we must purify our books. We must review what they have said is not a Quran. What the scholars have said is not Quran. It's not Hadith. They are a human being like us. What I am saying now is not Quran, it's not Hadith. I might be right, I might be wrong. So we have to use our guide, the Quran. Whoever is saying something, I have to put it against the Quran. If it is matching with this Quran, it's okay, on the top of my head. If it's not matching, sorry. Okay, so anyway, so Sulaiman alayhi salam, he knows the speech of the birds and the stuff. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all the miracles of the prophets and the messengers. So, any miracle Allah gave it to any prophets and the messenger, He gave all these miracles to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is for everyone. So, if he doesn't have the miracle that Sulaiman alayhi salam has, how those group of Sulaiman will believe in Prophet Muhammad sallam? If he doesn't have the miracle of Musa alayhi salam, how the children of Israel will believe in him, in Muhammad sallam? If he doesn't have the miracles of Isa alayhi salam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered all the miracles of the prophets and the messengers for Prophet Muhammad sallam. So when he was passing by and the camel called him, he understood that the camel is calling him. So he came to the camel. The camel put his head on the shoulder of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and start to talking to him. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam listening, looking his head, he's listening, understanding what the camel. After he finished, he went to the owner of the camel and he said, your camel is complaining against you. You are not feeding him in the proper way and alluding on him more than what he can. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you will be questioned about that. But what that mean? We must be kind to the animals. Okay? Because it is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is the way to achieve the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. But fasting is not just to stop eat and drink. Also, this body and this soul, as I said, when I feed it more than the body, what will happen? But the soul has a weight. Huh? Yani if I weigh myself while I'm still alive, and they weigh me after I die, huh? There is a difference in the... If I'm 100 kilo, I will be 100 kilo there. There's nothing. What that mean? It means the soul is... It's light. It's light. So it's flying. So if I feed my soul more than my body, then I will be flying. I will go up close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Ramadan, I'm doing that. If I'm fasting on the right way, because I am feeding my body less and I'm feeding my soul more. So the my soul will pull me. Then I will be like the angels. Because the angels, they have wings. They are flying, going upstairs. So if I be like that, if I manage to feed my soul more than my body, I will be flying like the angels. Because actually, Allah created me to be better than the angels. Allah created you to be better than the angels. Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا the angels? Allah said, we honor the son of Adam. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam. We honor the son of Adam. He didn't say we honor the angels, we honor the jinn. No. He said, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. we honor the son of Adam. And it was something, you know, just, it's not a joke, but something, you know, a man, once he was happy with his wife, okay? Of course, not all the time, but sometimes, you know, he was, okay? So he make an oath with divorce that she is better than the moon. She is more beautiful than the moon. Then he was, then after he woke up, he felt regret. Okay? So I said, yani, because she's not better than the moon. Yani, that's, then he said, oh my God. Now, my wife, she might be divorced from me, you know, because I make a false oath of divorce that she is better than the moon and she's not. So I went to ask one of the sheikh or imams. He told them the story and I said, of course, your wife is divorced. It's a disaster. I'm trying to please her or do something good to save myself in sleeping on the stairs. I divorced her. And he's, he was sad. He went to the some other imam and he asked him, he said to him, can you wait please until we finish the prayer? I will answer your question. So he waited. The second one, he was leading the prayer and he was reciting the surah of Wattini wa Zaytun wa Turi Sinin wa hadha al-balad al-amin laqad khalaqna al-insana fi ahsani taqwim. But instead if he say that, he said, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْقَمَرَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. He was leading the prayer and the other imam was behind him. The one who said to the man, your wife is divorced, he was praying behind. So the one is leading the prayer, he said, instead of he said, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. Indeed, we have created the human being in the best form. He said, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْقَمَرَ. Indeed, we have created the moon in the best. So the other one, he corrected him and said, خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. But he repeated again, خَلَقْنَا الْقَمَرَ. Created the moon. Three times. Then after the prayer, the one who praying behind said, oh, Sheikh, have you forgot the surah? And I'm keep correcting you. You're saying, خَلَقْنَا الْقَمَرَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. And Allah says, خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. I said, if you know that, Allah said, indeed, we have created the human being in the best form. Why you said to the man his wife is divorced? Indeed, his wife is better than the moon. Allah said that, not me. Okay? So this is how we need to understand yani, our religion. Okay? So, then, this spirit or this soul, it will be lifting me up to be even better than the angels. This is لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. This is how I achieve the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I control my eyes during the fasting, if I control my ears, control my tongue, all my organs must be fasting. If I do so, then I am planning to make my heart fasting and my mind fasting. This is the highest level of fasting. How my heart will be fasting? I keep none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my heart. I keep none in my mind but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the time I'm thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the time I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As our Prophet Muhammad sallam told us, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما. One of you will not be a believer until he loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger more than anything else. is that this is how we must fast. If we manage to do our fasting in that way, now we are entitled for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which what? Al-Jannah, the heaven. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, told us, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ بَابًا لَا يَدْخُلُهُ إِلَّا الصَّائِمُونَ يُقَالُ لَهُ الرَّيَّانِ. There is a special gate in the heaven. Only the fasting people will enter Jannah from this door. The name of this door, الرَّيَّان. So, if we manage to fast Ramadan, if we manage to pass this training course, then inshallah we'll be entitled for the Jannah. Because there is nothing, no reward less than the Jannah for Ramadan. No reward. Not with the way we are doing Ramadan. No, with the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like us to do Ramadan. Pray Taraweeh. I'm not against praying Taraweeh, of course. Because it is the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But prayed. Prophet Hassan, he prayed Taraweeh not more than 8 rakahs. That's it. Said Aisha, radiallahu anha, told us that Prophet Hassan, he never prayed more than 11 rakah. 8 Taraweeh and 3 witr. You can pray 100 rakah, of course. Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, in his time, because he found the Muslims, the reason how Taraweeh became 20, okay? He found the Muslims bringing in groups. This group bring in this corner, this group bring Taraweeh in this corner. So he gathered them and he increased the number from 8 rak'ahs to 20. Why? We have to understand why. Otherwise, some people will say, oh, it is bid'ah. Umar will never do bid'ah. Okay? But the reason is because Umar was using his brain as we should do. And Umar, as Prophet Muhammad said to him, لو كان نبي بعدي لكنته يا عمر. If there is any prophet after me, he was going to be that prophet. Because Umar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gave him a lot of vision. Once Umar ibn al-Khattab was standing and doing his speech in the mosque of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and suddenly he called, Ya Sariyat al-Jabal. Sariya is the name of the army leader was doing jihad in Persia. So he said, Ya Sariyat al-Jabal, al-Jabal. Then he resumed his khutbah. So the Muslim Sahaba, they asked him, Oh Umar, what happened? You cut your khutbah and you called the Sariya and you told him, al-Jabal, al-Jabal. He said, I saw the Muslim army. He's in Medina. And he saw the Muslim army in difficulty. And the enemy is about to surround them from the back, from the other side. So if they went back and they give their back to the mountain will protect them. So the enemy will not be able to surround them. So he called Sariya, the leader, go back to the mountain. Keep the mountain in your back. Then the enemy will not surround you. And Sariya there, he heard the voice of Umar. And he went back. But Umar not there. Not the one who will do bid'ah. Okay? So, but Umar, because when the Muslim used to pray in Mecca, the Qiyamul Layl or the night prayer, they used to do the 4 rak'ahs or the 2 rak'ahs and do tawaf. two rakas or four rakas and they do tawaf in between. But in Medina, there is no tawaf. So Umar replaced the tawaf they were doing in Mecca with additional rakas. So this is the reason that Umar, he made it 20 rakas and he gathered all the Muslims behind one imam. This is how it started. In the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, radiallahu anhu, the Umayyad Kareem, he increased the Taraweeh prayer to be 36 rak'ah. Why? Does Umar ibn Abdul Aziz also make a bid'ah? No. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he was following the steps of his grandfather, Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu. Because the Muslims at that time, they were living in very luxury life. So they moved away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They became busy with their dunya. So he would like to keep them in the mosque as long as he can. Then he moved them away from this dunya to try to change them. Okay? So this is the reason. So we must understand. We are not worshipping idols. We must understand the wisdom, the significance behind that. Okay. So we pray Taraweeh, mashallah. But we have also saying, you can't hold the book and pray Taraweeh from the book, from the Quran, while you are holding the book.
Oh, yeah.
Who said that? If there is any verse of the Quran telling me not to, if there is any hadith telling me you can't hold the book and read in your nafli prayer or taraweeh prayer or sunnah prayer, I can, of course. And I will be rewarded for, I will be getting double reward.
So we can hold the Quran?
Yes, of course. I will get double reward for that. The reward of reading. My eyes getting the reward. And the reward of reciting. And the reward of listening. Because it's not everyone memorizing the Quran. I know what they are saying. Not everyone is memorizing the Quran. The Sahaba used to be more than 120,000. How many they used to memorize the Quran among the Sahaba? Maybe 100 or 120 people only memorize the Quran. But the rest of the Muslims, how they used to pray? Huh? How they used to pray? If they didn't memorize the Quran, how they used to pray? Use our brain, please. Okay? So, you are allowed, inshallah. Allah knows better. But I'm saying, you are allowed to hold the book and read during your Taraweeh prayer, inshallah. Okay? But I can pray one rak'ah with two verses. But I'm deeply thinking about the meaning of the verses I'm reading. Because the Sahaba, when they used to read the Quran, or listen to the Imam reciting the Quran, if he passed by the verse talking about the hellfire, oh my God, they are crying, weeping, scared of the hellfire. If he passed by the verse talking about the heaven, or Jannah, or in the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are happy. Why? Because they are constrating on what they are reading or what they are listening. They understand what he is saying and they are living that. They are imagining. When the Quran talk, there is a verse talking about the hellfire, they're imagining they can see the hellfire. So they are jumping. If he talk about the Jannah, they are imagining they can see the Jannah and the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they are happy. If we manage to pray two rak'ah only with this understanding, I'm sure that in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these two rak'ahs will be better than the 1,000 rak'ah they are praying without understanding. Because our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبَلُ أَنْ يُعْبَدَ بِجَهْلٍ. Allah will never accept to be worshipped with ignorance. We must learn how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the reason for this khilas. We need to learn. No justice to come to Allahu Akbar. Why you are doing? Why you are doing? What benefit will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you're coming to the mosque and doing these actions? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like your benefit. He would like to reward you, so would like you to be in touch with Him. To link yourself to Him. How you will link yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless you are sincere. You are aware about why you are saying, what you are doing. So pray tarawih inshaAllah. Pray. Because our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in his speech at the end of Sha'ban, he said, يا أيها الناس ومنكين. See, قد أظل لكم شهر عظيم مبارك. Ahead of you, a great month, blessed month. جعل الله صيام يومه فريضة وقيام ليله تطوعا. Allah made the fasting of the daytime of this month compulsory, and the prayer, the night prayer, voluntarily, تطوعا. If you think about this part of the speech, does Prophet Muhammad sallam said أيها المسلمون or أيها المؤمنون, but said أيها الناس womankind. This is to confirm that the talk of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is matching with the Quran. Matching the Quran. Quran told us Ramadan was compulsory in the nations before us. And the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling all mankind, Ramadan is ahead for all of you. But this is month. Even the non-Muslim should think about this month. It's not only Muslims. Okay? So we fast the daytime and we pray in the night time, but we pray with understanding. Okay? What is it we need to do in Ramadan? Reconciliation. With what? Fast. Reconciliation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first step. With Ramadan, all of us sinners, all of us mistakers, no one can claim that he is fit and he is... No, except the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's it. No one else. All of us sinners. So in Ramadan, I say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, please forgive me. I repent sincerely. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek the forgiveness for what I have done in the past. Promising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will never go back to the sins. I might do, but my intention not to do. Sincerely, and seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable me not to commit sins. Because without the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will never be able to do it. But with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, you will move away from the sins, from the mistakes. Okay? This is the reconciliation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reconciliation with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We must say sorry to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After we say sorry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we must say sorry to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we ignored his sunnah. We ignored his sunnah. Does Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was bad to anyone? To anyone? No way. Does he was bad to the animals or to the... He was calling Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He gave him this name, Abu Huraira, because Abu Huraira, he used to get a little cat, okay, and he put it here in his sleeve, okay? So Prophet ﷺ called him Abu Huraira, because Huraira, Hira, Qitta, the cat. That's the Arabic name, okay? So a small Qitta, the kitten, we call it Huraira. Yeah, small cat. So he gave him this name. And we know Abu Huraira, he narrated thousands of hadiths from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he didn't ask him, no, throw this away. How you come to me with this? Never happened. Okay? So we must say sorry to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we ignored his sunnah. He came as a mercy for us. He was very concerned. And he's still concerned about us. Because our deeds shown to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam every week. So he is happy if our deeds is good. And he's upset if our deeds is bad. So we need to say, Prophet, we will not embarrass you again. We will follow your sunnah. We will do whatever you ask us to do. Because this is what the Quran told us. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked you to do, do it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. We must listen to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He told us, do that, do it. Don't do that, don't do it. Because the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam explaining the things which we couldn't understand from the Quran. You know, when the judge come to the court and he make the statement about a case and they give him this sentence to someone, okay, he said just a few words. But you know, this the folder is like that, okay? This folder explaining the laws he used and how he come to this conclusion and all this stuff, okay? This bundle is this big, okay? This is the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Quran is the statement of the judge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then this explanation is the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we must listen. We can't ignore the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad. So in Ramadan, we are doing reconciliation with Prophet Muhammad, telling him, oh Prophet, we are sorry. We ignored your sunnah. And this is why you are in this situation now. Why you are humiliated and oppressed. Because we ignored our religion. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu came to receive the keys from the Archbishop of Al-Quds. You know, the Muslim came to Al-Quds. The army who came to Al-Quds, the leader was Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu. He was the army leader. When they came, Al-Quds is a sacred city. So they didn't attack the city. MashaAllah, our people now who claim that they are Muslims, okay, they are killing everyone, they don't care, okay? But Muslim at that time, because they used to be Muslim, they used to be believer, so they stop outside the courts, and they requested the Archbishop to give them the key. He refused to give them the key. Can you imagine if the people of that time, like the ISIS people or those people who claim they are Muslims, can you imagine what their reaction if the archbishop he refused to give them the keys? Straight out they will kill him. No doubt about that. But see what they ask him why. He said, I will never hand the key to anyone but Umar ibn al-Khattab,
your Khalifa.
Subhanallah. How he knows Umar ibn al-Khattab? He never seen Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab never came to Palestine. But how he, the description of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companion there in the Torah and in the Injil, in the Old Testament and the New Testament, their description is there. So they knew. They knew him. So Abu Ubaidah, he sent to call Umar ibn al-Khattab from Medina to Palestine. He came with this jilbab, you know, this stitches. Huh? He's not wearing a suit. And he's not coming with the special flight. No, he's riding a donkey. Okay, from Medina to Palestine. When he came, and Abu Ubaidah, yeah, told him that they are waiting for you. But they requested Umar. Yani, they told him, yani, you know, those people, they are materialistic, wearing nice clothes, this and stuff. So if you go like that, they might disrespect you. So it's better if you change this jilbab and they prepare a jilbab for him, nice one. Okay? And they prepare another animal, better than this donkey, for him to go with. So he reviews, but they keep pressurizing him until he done it. He bought the jilbab, the new one, and he tried to ride this animal. He ride from this side, he follow from the other side. Ride from that side, follow from the other side. Umar, he can't ride the, okay? So he took the jilbab off, the new one, throw it to them, and he got his donkey, and he said something. نحن قوم أعزنا الله بالإسلام فإن ابتغينا العزة في غيره أذلنا الله. We are the people that Allah honor them with Islam. If we seek the honor in something else, we'll be humiliated. And this is what happening to us. Because we are seeking the honor in something else, we forgot Islam. So Ramadan is our time to reconciliate our relationship with Prophet Muhammad and tell him that, oh Prophet Muhammad, we believe in what you have told us. We will follow your sunnah and we will come back to our Islam. Okay. Then reconciliation with our parents. Some people, unfortunately, to say some who claim that they are Muslims, they sometimes ring their parents in the on the Father Day or Mother Day or something like that. Okay. What that mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah stated that you worship him only and be dutiful to the parents. You shouldn't say no to them. Never say no to them. Whatever they ask you to do, do it. Only one thing you can disobey them. Only one thing. فَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَنْ تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطْعِهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. If they ask you to associate partner, to worship another God with me, then say no. But say no with the nice way. No. No. Are you mad? No. Say no to them in the nice way. And be dutiful to them in this dunya. Some of our beloved people, if they manage to get someone to convert to Islam, they start to them, your parents, they are kafir. Don't talk to them. Don't eat from their food. Don't see them. Don't do that. Subhanallah al-Azim. Allah is saying, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفٌ. And you are telling him, cut your relationship with your parents because they are non-Muslims. And don't eat their food. And don't do that. Subhanallah. Who said that? This is the reason the people, they hate Islam. Can you imagine if someone take away your son or your daughter from you? Are you going to be happy with him or with her? Never. So you are taken, if someone came to Islam and you are taking him away from his parents, how do we expect that his parents will be happy with us? I must encourage him to be more dutiful to them than before. More nice, more kind to them than before, to show them the beauty of Islam. This is how our religion taught us. So reconciliate with your parents. Go prostrate before them, kiss their feet, and ask their forgiveness. Because Allah will never forgive you unless your parents will forgive you. If your parents are unhappy with you, don't expect. When the man was dying, one of the Sahaba, he was dying, and the rest, they are around him. Our duty, if someone is dying, we need to tell him, ask him to say shahada. Say, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So, whenever they are telling him that, his tongue stuck. He couldn't say ashhadu. Oh, Sahaba got worried. If they ask him to say anything else, oh, saying, flooding. But say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, he's done. Subhanallah. They run to Prophet Muhammad, scared, concerned about him. Then Prophet Muhammad asked, A'alayhi dayn? Does he have a debt? Does he borrow some money and he hasn't repaid? They said, no. Second question. Alahu abawain? Ala qayd al hayat, they still. Does his parents still alive? They said, his father passed away, but his mother is still alive. Then Prophet said, call her. Ask her to come. They called her. Then Prophet asked her, how's your son? She said, he is, mashallah, fasting the daytime, standing to pray the night time. The Prophet said, no, I'm not asking you about that. I'm asking you, how is he with you? How is he with you? She said, his mashallah, he's good, but, when we say but, it means disaster. Okay. But what? But when he used to get something, fruit or sweet or something or food, he used to go fast to his wife and children, give them, and they come back to me with the rest. And this used to upset me. That's it. Then Prophet said, khalas, this is the reason. This is the reason. But Prophet Muhammad, he would like her to forgive him. Yes, if he asks her to forgive him, she will do it. She will listen and obey to Prophet Muhammad. But see the cleverness of Prophet Muhammad. We need to learn. She might obey and listen, but is not coming from her heart. She will do it to please Prophet Muhammad. but is not coming from her heart, then it will not be acceptable. Prophet Muhammad, he would like this forgiveness to come out of her heart. So he looked at the companion and said, okay, go and collect wood and the fuel for me and make a big fire. The Sahaba is getting ready to do whatever Prophet Muhammad asked him to do. So the lady said, oh Prophet Muhammad, for what this fire? Prophet said, for your son? To burn him, to put him in the fire. He was upsetting you. So soon he will die, he will go to the fire. So what big difference? There's no big difference if we put him in the fire from now. So we will make this big fire to put him in the... The woman said, no, please. You are my witness. I forgive him. Soon she said that, his tongue said, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. See, this is reconciliation with our parents. Inshallah, we'll stop at this point, inshallah. And we'll carry on, inshallah, next Sunday.